Rowan. Welcome to this Belinda audiobook, Bindi Wildlife Adventures, books 1-4. You'll hear me reading my diary entries at the start of each book, and at the end, I'll share with you some great fact files about the animals in the stories. Miranda Nation will be reading the stories.
Bindi Wildlife Adventures, book 1, Trouble at the Zoo.
Dear Diary, happy birthday to me. I've just had the biggest and most awesome birthday ever. Hundreds of people were wandering around the zoo wearing snorkels and masks. It was hilarious. Robert had tentacles flying everywhere, and my best friend Rosie made me this beautiful costume. We raised heaps of money to help stop illegal whaling. My birthday cake was delicious and the slippery dip was crazy fun, but then that boy Zach almost spoiled it all by... Hang on, maybe I should take a deep breath and tell you all about it. Bindi.
Chapter 1. As the sun rose on another beautiful day on the Sunshine Coast, an enormous Burmese python slithered slowly into a bedroom. In the distance, the call of the ring-tailed lemurs signalled the start of a new day. Lying asleep in bed, the young girl didn't notice the snake's progress. The snake took a leisurely route towards the bed, slowly winding up the bedpost until its head came to rest on the pillow. The snake's tongue flickered in and out, touching the girl's face. The girl's face twitched a little, but her eyes remained closed. The snake let out another quiet hiss. The girl's hand reached out and slowly came to rest on the head of the snake. Feels scaly? Bindi Irwin opened her eyes and smiled. The snake smiled back. Have you come to wish me a happy birthday, Basil? Bindi's mum, Terri, and her brother Robert entered the bedroom, still in their PJs, and started singing. Happy birthday to you, happy birthday to you. Bindi jumped out of bed, super excited. Yay! She rushed over to her mum and brother and gave them both a big hug. Robert thought Basil would make a perfect birthday alarm clock, Terri said with a smile. Good thinking, little buddy, Bindi replied. What's for breakfast, mum? I think you might already know the answer to that, Bindi, Terri replied. Woohoo! It's pancakes! Robert and Bindi high-fived. Robert moved over to the bed to pick up Basil, who looked like he would be quite happy to snooze on Bindi's bed for the rest of the day. Come on, lazy bones, Robert said as he lifted the snake onto his shoulders. We've got pancakes to eat. He zoomed out of the room towards the kitchen. Terri looked down at Bindi and gave her a kiss on the forehead. Our little girl's growing up. Your dad would have loved to be here today, sweetheart. Bindi gave her mum's hand a squeeze. I know, mum, she said. He'd have wanted it to be a fantastic day. And it will be, Terri replied, looking at her watch with a worried expression. Oops, as long as we get a move on. Bindi and Terri headed off down the hallway. You and Basil better have left some for us, Robert, Bindi called out along the way. Chapter 2. The Irwin family lived at Australia Zoo. They were a family dedicated to wildlife conservation. Bindi's dad, Steve, had helped change attitudes towards crocodiles with his huge enthusiasm and love for the creatures. Australia Zoo had started off as a reptile park, and they still loved their reptiles, but it had now grown into a big, beautiful zoo, complete with giraffes, tigers, and elephants, as well as a whole swag of gorgeous Australian animals. After Bindi's dad had passed away, Bindi had made a promise to continue her dad's great work alongside her family. She planned to keep that promise for the rest of her life. And her birthday was a yearly reminder of all the good that could come of passing on the message of wildlife conservation to as many people as possible. She loved her birthday parties at Australia Zoo. This year was an underwater-themed birthday, and money earned from the day would go towards preventing whaling in Antarctica. Bindi and Robert had just finished their last mouthfuls of delicious pancake when there was a knock at the front door.
"I'll get it,"
Robert said, and ran to open the door. There on the doorstep was a very pretty mermaid.
Bindi, there's a mermaid here."
Robert cast a suspicious look at the mermaid and sped off down the corridor. Bindi raced to the door.
"Oh my gosh, you look amazing, Rosie."
Rosie Bellamy was Bindi's best friend. They had known each other since they were tiny. Rosie's dad was a vet at the wildlife hospital, and her mum worked at the zoo too, so Rosie and Bindi got to spend heaps of time together. Rosie laughed.
"I wasn't sure if all the glitter was a bit much. I think I sort of scared your brother away."
Bindi giggled.
"I promise you, Robert doesn't scare that easily."
Rosie held up a bag.
"Happy birthday. I've got it, and it's going to look awesome."
Bindi squealed with excitement.
"Come on, let's go to my bedroom and try it on."
"Okay, but don't walk too fast. Mermaids are more used to swimming than walking." 10 minutes later, a very regal-looking emperor penguin was knocking at Bindi's bedroom door.
"Bindi, Rosie, are you ready? We've got a zoo to open."
From behind the closed door, Terri the emperor penguin could hear giggling.
"Come on, girls." "Almost ready, Mum. Just putting the finishing touches."
Bindi's voice dissolved into giggles once more. A moment later, the door opened. Rosie the mermaid stepped out, pulling the door closed behind her.
"Hi, Terri. Wow, nice outfit. I have something very important to tell you. Bindi is no longer in the bedroom. Instead, I would like to introduce you to the one, the only, Stella the seahorse."
Rosie opened the door and a twirling, whirling vision of sparkliness made her way out of the bedroom. Bindi was dressed in a golden-coloured leotard with a layered golden skirt. The back of the leotard was draped in shimmery golden material, which looked like the frill along a seahorse's spine. She also wore a mask with a long, delicate nose. Bits of emerald green material, looking like seaweed, were strewn across Bindi's costume. Terri was impressed.
"Wow, girls, I think this underwater-themed birthday is going to be a hit. You've made such a great costume for Bindi, Rosie."
Rosie blushed.
"Oh, it was nothing really. You know me and Mum like sewing."
Bindi interrupted her friend.
"It is not nothing. It's awesome. I love seahorses. They're such graceful and gentle creatures, and this costume is the best present ever."
Bindi gave Rosie a big hug. Terri pulled out a camera.
"Okay, girls, we've got time for a quick photo. Now hold it. One, two, cockatoo!"
The girls struck a pose, which was interrupted a millisecond later by Robert, dressed as a blue-ringed octopus, launching himself between the two girls. Robert misjudged his jump.
"Robert!"
And the two girls shrieked as all three sea creatures tumbled down in a tentacled, seaweedy heap, just as Terri took the photo. Picture perfect. Not. Chapter 3. In the car park, families were already spilling out of their cars, attaching snorkels, masks, flippers, goggles or floaties, and making their way towards the zoo entrance. There was lots of excited chatter. Holly Brown, aged 6, was dressed up like a blue swimmer crab. She had been looking forward to coming to Bindi's birthday ever since the day she was born, so she said, and this year her dream had come true. Today also happened to be her brother's birthday, so normally she would be hanging around while her brother and his friends threw sand at each other and had competitions to see who could eat cake the fastest or who could do the biggest burp after drinking lots of fizzy drink. Yuck. She was glad she wasn't ever going to be a boy. This year, Holly's mum and dad had promised her they would all go to Bindi's birthday. Holly's brother, Zach, stood out from the rest of the excited crowd. It wasn't that he looked any different. He was wearing goggles, like plenty of other kids, and his mum was trying to slather him in sunscreen, like plenty of other kids. The difference was that Zach Brown wore a frown. Not one single other person, young or old, big or small, was doing anything but smiling. Holly just couldn't understand it. She knew her brother really loved animals, especially reptiles, so even though he had been the grumpiest brother a sister had ever had to put up with during the car journey here, she knew he'd really enjoy being at Australia Zoo today. It's just that to look at him, you wouldn't know.
Hurry up, Zach. I don't want to be the last in the queue to get in.
Holly was holding her mum and dad's hands and skipping fast, making a beeline towards the entrance. Zach was mooching behind them. There's no rush, okay? We'll be waiting in line forever anyway. It's not even 9 o'clock yet. Mr. Brown, who was dressed as a sea monster and covered head to foot in seaweed, turned and gave his son one of those stern, "Be nice to your sister" looks before he was dragged away. Zach watched as a bakery van pulled up to the zoo entrance and two delivery men manoeuvred a large birthday cake out of the van's back doors. Well, on the plus side, he did love cake, and that cake looked big enough to feed an elephant. He moved closer to the delivery men. Perhaps he could run up and sneak a taste of the icing. It looked really good. He inched a little closer. Mrs. Brown glanced over at her son.
Zach, keep out of the men's way. Come over here and join the queue.
Zach sighed as he watched the cake carried through the front entrance. No, he did not like the way his 10th birthday was turning out, and it had only just begun. Chapter 4. All over the zoo, staff dressed as dolphins, swordfish, slippery eels, and every underwater creature you could think of were buzzing around, helping set up for the day's many activities. Bindi, Robert, and Rosie made their way around the zoo, taking in the extraordinary sights. Slippery dips and music stages were ready for action. Aquamarine helium balloons were tied to signposts, and enormous bubble machines were getting a test run. A few of the zoo's employees with walkie-talkies in hand were busy making sure the three kids didn't see anything that would spoil the surprises the day had in store. Keeper one to keeper three. A zookeeper dressed as a pufferfish whispered into his walkie-talkie as he sped past the kids in a golf buggy. There's a mermaid, a seahorse, and an octopus heading to the croc enclosures now. Move that cake out of there pronto. Over by the crocs, a dolphin and two clownfish were moving the whale-sized birthday cake when the walkie-talkie crackled through its message. The three froze in position for a moment and then started scampering off in the opposite direction. The clownfish kept hold of the cake while the dolphin answered the call. Copy that, Keeper One, or should I call you Pufferfish One? Cake taking a detour via the Tassie Devils. Over. Just past the croc enclosure, Bindi waved to a starfish setting up a popcorn stand. The zoo is always an amazing place, she said to Rosie and Robert, but today it looks even more amazing than usual. Yeah, piped up Robert. Maybe everyone should dress up as underwater creatures every day. That'd be cool, said Bindi, although I wonder if it would confuse the animals if their keepers began looking like animals themselves. Rosie pointed to a creature who was busy trimming a tree nearby.
Is he dressed as a snail? That isn't an underwater creature, is it?
The snail overheard the comment and turned to the kids indignantly.
I'll have you know, I'm not a garden snail, but a sea snail. Look at the stripes on my shell. I'm a Cavistana snail, of course.
Rosie giggled.
Well, excuse me, Mr. Snail, I do apologise. I don't know as much about gastropods as I should.
Apology accepted, said the snail, bowing solemnly, because you're such a polite...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.